This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
The most precious thing on this earth is the human brain, and yet we allow it to die.
It is quite useless to resist, as we are stronger and more efficient than your earth people.
You belong to us. You shall be like us.
The ascension shall begin.
The strength and might of the cyber race will be confirmed.
Pain.
I am Vanguard.
Pain.
November 1983 was Doctor Who's 20th anniversary, and for the occasion, producer John Nathan Turner wanted to do something special, a madcap adventure, featuring not one, not two, not three, not four, no, not even five Doctors, but six Doctors. And yes, you heard that right. The original script for this story was called The Six Doctors, and would unite all five incarnations to fight the Cybermen in a script written by Robert Holmes. And get this, the plot revolved around the Cybermen kidnapping the Doctors to extract their Time Lord DNA so they could turn themselves into Cyber Lords, with the sixth Doctor of the title revealed to be an android imposter who was disguised as the First Doctor. However, Robert Holmes dropped out, and writing duties changed to the man, the myth, the legend, Terrence Dicks. But this was no easy task, with the script constantly being rewritten due to the ever-shifting cast, with companions and actors dropping out, coming back in, left, right and centre, including the fourth Doctor, Tom Baker, not wanting to play 20% of the lead role, and he dropped out, though he did agree to do a 20th anniversary photo shoot with the rest of the Doctors. But he didn't turn up, meaning the production had to replace him with a Madame Tussauds wax figurine. After that, we have the casting of Richard Herndl to take over the role from the late William Hartnell, the Australian Broadcasting Corporation helping to foot a portion of the bill, and primetime exposure for 1983's Children in Need, and you've got one of the show's most ambitious events. And I think that's the best way to approach the Five Doctors, not as a story, but as an event. This was one hell of a difficult project to put together, and it also serves more as a celebration of the show, as opposed to a coherent, compelling story. It's a chance for audiences and families to see some of their favourite characters and monsters turn up for charity in an entertaining TV blockbuster. And on that front, the story succeeds with flying colours. But let me back up. The story opens with the fifth Doctor and companions Tegan and newcomer Turlough, played by Mark Strickson, relaxing at the Eye of Orion, when the Doctor suddenly starts having an out-of-body experience. His former selves and companions are being plucked out of time and space, pickled in time like gherkins in a... Oh, sorry, that's the wrong special. They've been taken to the Death Zone on Gallifrey, a barren wasteland where Time Lords used to drop random species and watch them fight in battle royales for their amusement. The only thing saving the fifth Doctor from disappearing altogether is that the fourth Doctor's displacement went wrong, leaving him in limbo. It's up to the other incarnations to unite, discover what's hiding in the Tomb of Rassilon, and fight their way past countless perils to escape the Death Zone and return to their appropriate time and places. So this story has the first, second, third and fifth Doctors, former companions Susan, Sarah Jane, Ciri Staple, the Brigadier, and also cameo appearances from Jamie, Zoe, Liz, Mike Yates, K-9, with the fourth Doctor and Romana appearing through stock footage from the unfinished Sharda story, which is a really clever compromise for the time. As for the villains, we have a Dalek, the Cybermen with their leader, Anthony Ainley as the Master, the Yeti in a rotting costume that had been left in storage for 15 years and was falling apart, and the Time Lords. This story must have been like catnip for fans in 1983, and it still holds up as a viewing experience on that level, because there's so much going on and it moves so quickly. Because of the large cast being split up in so many directions, what could have just been scenes of the Doctor travelling around wastelands for large stretches can be edited around, and the audience can watch something more immediate. it's a testament to Terrence Dicks that this thing works at all, let alone as well as it does. It's also held together by the cast, as Troughton and Pertwee, despite being away from the roles for so long, clearly haven't lost a step. Same goes for Elizabeth Sladen, and pairing her up with the Third Doctor, her original Doctor, was such a clever idea, and the Brigadier and Second Doctor always make for an inspired double act.
I'm sorry, sir, you're not allowed in there.
Not allowed? Me?
I'm allowed everywhere.
Oh, thank you.
Brigadier.
Good heavens!
Is it you?
Yes, yes. For once, I was able to steer the TARDIS.
And here I am.
And who is this?
That's Colonel Crichton, my replacement.
Ah. Yes, mine was pretty unpromising, too.
Come along, Doctor. We'll take a stroll round the ground, shall we? awfully sorry about this. Do excuse me for a moment.
You've had this place redecorated, haven't you? Don't like it.
Come along, Doctor.
This separation of the Doctors also allows them to take different entrances into the Tower of Rassilon. The Second Doctor and the Brig take the underground route, the First Doctor and Tegan take the main door, and of course the action hero Third Doctor climbs up a mountain with an exasperated Sarah Jane to zip line to the entrance on the roof. As for the Fifth Doctor, well, funny story. Firstly, he's able to be brought to strength by being near the First Doctor again as he finds his TARDIS in the Death Zone. The Fifth Doctor goes out to investigate and stumbles across the Master, played by Anthony Ainley. See, the Master has been summoned by the Time Lords to save the Doctor from whatever is being done to him, and in return, he'll receive a pardon and a new set of regenerations. This is basically all the Master could ever want, so he approaches the Fifth Doctor with true intentions. He wants to help him with no ulterior motive, but the Fifth Doctor doesn't believe him, especially when a group of Cybermen show up and start attacking, and in the skirmish, the Doctor gets a hold of the Master's lifeline to the Time Lords and gets transported back to his people. It's this subplot that the Fifth Doctor finds himself in. All the while, the Master encounters the Third Doctor, and he doesn't believe him either, and just leaves him at the side of the road.
I take it you are responsible for our being in the Death Zone?
For once, I'm innocent. Here at the High Council's request to help you. And your other self.
You? Sent here by the Time Lords to help me? I've never heard such arrant nonsense.
I happen to be telling the truth. I carry the seal of the High Council.
It's forged, no doubt.
See for yourself.
Stolen, then? I'll return it to the first opportunity.
I would prefer more positive proof of your credentials. One of your other selves took it from me. Do you expect me to believe the fantastic tale you've just told?
When he does eventually meet all of the Doctors, he is pissed that the one time he is trying to help them, he got shot down and neglected, and then he tries to kill them, only to get knocked out by the Brigadier. It's such a fun mini-story within the Five Doctors that never gets enough credit. It's also fun to see him team up with the Cybermen, who serve as almost secondary antagonists here. This could be Anthony Ainley's best performance as the Master.
The fortress of the Time Lords is at your mercy.
Why was the main gate left unguarded?
Oh, the Time Lords believe no one could survive the Death Zone. It's a sort of woolly thinking that'll bring about their destruction.
The Cybermen have also been brought to the Death Zone, and while they have a strong start by attacking the Brigadier and then the Fifth Doctor with the Master, they are completely out of their depth for the rest of the story. And I love it. Yes, overusing this idea too many times could be detrimental to your villains, but in the Five Doctors, the Cybermen's failures absolutely work, because even the Doctor is dealing with powers he can't meddle with. But more on that later. The Cybermen, while pursuing the Third Doctor and Sarah Jane Smith, meet a Ranston warrior robot, the most perfect killing machine ever created. Its sensors can detect any movement and its weapons are built in. So, what happens when one Ranston warrior robot goes up against a platoon of Cybermen?
Oh!
That was the most brutal thing I have ever watched in what's meant to be a kid's show. That Cyberman was vomiting. And then in Rassilon's tower, there's a checkerboard floor which is deadly when you get halfway across, and the Master, in his brutal way, just leads the Cybermen through it.
Wasn't that a little ruthless, even for you?
In one of the many wars on your miserable little planet, they used to drive sheep across minefields. Principles to save.
It's so cool to see the Cybermen have such an active presence in this story. Because of their practical costumes, they can roam about the Welsh countryside as opposed to the Dalek, which only has one scene in a studio corridor and is quickly disposed of. I'm glad the Daleks did get represented here, but production issues obviously limited their use. It's also great to see David Banks again as the Cyber Leader. While we're here, let's do the excellent counter.
I have found the ones from the TARDIS.
Excellent.
But it's with this where we get a demonstration of just how much David Banks' voice adds to this character. The Master, he kills the Cyber Leader in the Tower of Rassilon, but apparently there's another one outside preparing to destroy the Fifth Doctor's TARDIS, and it's just not the same.
Leader, the bombs are ready.
Excellent. Prepare for detonation.
All is prepared.
Excellent.
Speaking of casting, I've seen people give Richard Herndl a bad rap, and while I get it, these are massive shoes to fill, this was 1983. It's not like we were able to go on YouTube or watch old recordings of Hartnell to get all of the mannerisms down, but Herndl does a good job at embodying the warmer, slightly egocentric side of the First Doctor. The story doesn't ask much from him, meaning that it's hard for him to come across as more than just a bog-standard First Doctor impression, but that's not Herndl's fault. He was absolutely up to the task required of him. And I think he did well here. We also have him to thank for opening the door to recasting these Doctors after the actors pass away. Without Herndl, there might be no David Bradley or Tim Treloar in the Doctor Who universe. But it is the material that prevents him from becoming more, which is also notable with Susan's inclusion. Carol Ann Ford absolutely drew the short straw here. You've got a woman in her 40s shouting "Grandfather" everywhere, and it's just not working here. She spends most of the story in the TARDIS with Turlough, waiting for the Cybermen to blow them up, and then at the end of the story, she meets Doctors 2, 3, and 5, and they have nothing to say to her? Yes, this is an anniversary special, and it's just great to have Carol Ann Ford back, but nothing? At all? The Five Doctors opens with the First Doctor's speech to her as he said goodbye. Like, surely there's something that could have been done here. Susan even hurts her ankle for seemingly no other reason than making her more ineffectual. Also, speaking of falls and injuries and stuff, Sarah Jane gets defeated by a very slight incline that the Third Doctor has to engineer a pretty elaborate pulley system to save her from, despite him probably just being able to climb down there and get her. To be fair though, the original script and the novelization states that it was more of a cliff edge than just a tiny slope. And I also understand that madness does lie in the direction of trying to find all of the potential character beats and moments that could have been done in what is a 90-minute celebration special for the mainstream and for hardcore fans alike. Terrence Dicks does, for the most part, keep the continuity in check, with the Second and Third Doctor's dislike for one another staying true to their last anniversary special.
Time to go, Brigadier.
Well, goodbye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Fancy pants.
Scarecrow.
The First Doctor also doesn't recognise the Master when he meets him in Rassilon's tower.
Do I know you, young man?
Believe it or not, we were at the Academy together.
And Sarah Jane Smith is in possession of K-9, effectively making K-9 and company canon.
Danger! Doctor! Danger! Mistress!
But on the other hand, the Second Doctor's meeting with illusions of Jamie and Zoe and bringing up their memory loss in his final story ended up creating a continuity issue so large that fans had to invent an entirely new side season to explain it away in Season 6B. And that is incredible to me. Speaking of second to third Doctor transitions, Terrence Dicks was the script editor for the Third Doctor's era, and you can see that he has a particular affinity to that incarnation in this story. He gets most of the fan service callbacks, like driving Bessie, reversing the polarity of the neutron flow, and...
Lethbridge Stewart? Oh, my dear fella, how very nice to see you again.
Great heavens, you as well.
I don't know why. Like, I obviously didn't grow up in the 70s to watch these two on screen. I didn't even grow up in the 80s. But this moment hit me pretty hard. So, who is the actual villain of the story? Well, the Fifth Doctor hangs out with the Time Lords as they try to unravel the conspiracy, made more complicated when the Black Scrolls of Rassilon containing dark Time Lord knowledge is discovered in the room of the Castellan, which leads to one of the most famous lines of the entire show.
Commander, you are authorized to use the mind probe.
What? No, not the mind probe.
But no, it turns out not to be the Castellan, but Time Lord President Barusa, who seeks immortality from Rassilon's tomb, and needed the Death Zone clearing of threats before he could do so. Even though he just teleports into the mausoleum at the end anyway without needing to set foot in the Death Zone proper, but whatever. Barusa really went all out with this plan. Look, he even made tiny figurines of the Doctor and his companions to place on the game board, and you can own all of these, starting with the 11th Doctor along with a collectible magazine. Issue 1 starts at just $2.99.
Collect them all with this anniversary Doctor Who figurine collection. Officially approved, each figurine is cast in metallic resin and hand-painted to capture every detail. The Doctor Who figurine collection, out now.
As half-formed and cliché a character as Barusa is, I do like actor Philip Latham here. He's got a really quiet strength to him, and he also delivers my favourite line in the special.
I am Lord President of Gallifrey, and you are the Notorious Renegades.
Earlier on, I referred to the Cybermen having to deal with these threats outside of their understanding, and now it's time to return to that point. You see, Barusa wants immortality, and needs to get it by speaking to the spirit of Rassilon, the founder of Time Lord Society, and he appears to Barusa and informs him that he needs to wear his ring in order to attain immortality. Barusa does so, and...
Others have come to claim immortality through the ages. It was given to them, as it shall be given to you. Your place is prepared, Lord President Barusa.
Oh.
This is a really clever and appropriate story resolution, where the Doctor is an active and important participant, but he's not the one to defeat the villain. They're part of a story, the Doctors are part of a story and a mythology that is much bigger and more powerful than they are, and if they had fought Rassilon or something similar and then won, it might belittle the concept of Time Lord Society and make any threat the character faced in the future seem insignificant by comparison. It really is the best of both worlds, and also allows for this great reaction.
And what of you, Doctors? Do you claim immortality too?
No, my lord. No, all we ask that we be returned to our proper place in time and space.
The Doctors and their companions say their goodbyes.
Goodbye, Doctor.
Goodbye.
Doctors,
Brigadier.
Splendid fellows, all of you.
And the story ends with Chancellor Flavia arriving to inform the Doctor that due to Barusa's absence, he is now the acting president of Gallifrey. The Doctor asks her to summon a meeting with the High Council, that Flavia has all of his powers as president while he's gone, hops into his TARDIS with a brand new console unit, which is awesome, and he flies away.
Won't the Time Lords be very angry?
Furious!
You mean you're deliberately choosing to go on the run from your own people? In a rackety old TARDIS?
Why not? After all, that's how it all started.
Perfect. Love that ending. Love those final lines. Terrence Dicks, you legend. Now, you can nitpick the Five Doctors a lot, but I don't think you can nitpick it to death. Its fundamentals are so strong, its dialogue and performances so endearing, that I can't really imagine anyone hating the story. Disliking it, sure, but hate? That's a strong emotion, and this special's hearts are in just the right places to hold any sort of resentment against it. Yeah, I can complain about Susan, the wasted Dalek, some questionable plot points and details and motives and plot holes, but the Five Doctors is just a fun time. It's great to see these actors again, it's fun to see these team-ups and pairings, the villains like the Master and the Cybermen are so much fun, and the ending feels not only appropriate for a team-up of this scale, but also works to ensure the show's longevity and path forward into the future. It's just a bit depressing in hindsight that the program wouldn't survive in its current form past this decade. I wouldn't recommend The Five Doctors as an introduction to Classic Who, but it does showcase the best that the 1980s had to offer, and I hugely admire everyone on the creative team for not only sticking the landing, but doing so to this level. Yes, Terrence Dicks was the perfect guy to write this story, but let's not also forget John Nathan Turner, showing once and for all why he was such a great showman for the programme. Well, that was a fun digression during Cybercember. I had to pad out the month somehow due to a shortage of stories, but join me tomorrow, where the Cybermen, sick of being supporting players, go on the attack. I'll see you folks next time.